Welcome to Smart Catalyst, October 30, 2018. So first we are going to see the prelims articles. They are children under 15 are at risk. Delhi tops in bad air quality. CSIR develops less polluting firecrackers. India's largest dry dock at Cochin shipyard and the places in recent news, as well as Facebook leaks Redux. So the first article is children under 15 at serious risk from polluted air. So it is said by WHO, which is the World Health Organization. So what the news here is, recently the World Health Organization has conducted the first ever global conference on air pollution and health. And in that conference, they released a report which tells us about the air pollution impact on child health as well as on the global population's health. So now we are going to look into the child health implementation due to the pollution. So in that report, they stated nearly 93% of world's children under the age of 15, they are breathe polluted air every day. So it is approximately 1.8 billion children in the entire world. So this breathing of polluted air obviously put the children's health and their development at serious risk. And they also stated or justified this with the data, which provides as many as 6 lakh children are estimated to be perished in the year 2016 due to the complications from acute lower respiratory infection. So it is caused by dirty air. So why we are stressing more on children in the sense, because it is having that much severe impact in children than in adults. Why? Because the first major reason is the children breathe more rapidly than adults. So obviously they are going to inhale more pollutants than the adults. So that is the first major reason. So the second major reason is the children live usually closer to the ground where the pollutants concentration is very high. And the childhood is the period where the brains and the bodies of the children are still in developing stage. So at that stage, if they are going to inhale more pollutants, then obviously it is going to hamper the growth of the children, both physically as well as mentally, right? And the third major reason is the newborns and the small children are often at home. So whatever activities which is carried out in the home, like burning the fuels or woods, it is also again a major threat to the children's growth. So what are the major impacts of this pollution in the sense? The first major impact is when the pregnant women are continuously exposed to these pollution, then it is more likely to be resultant in giving birth to premature children, which is having very small and low birth weight children. Obviously, they are not having any kind of immune power in their body, right? And the second one is this pollution also impacts neurodevelopment as well as the cognitive ability of the children. And the third one is it can trigger asthma as well as childhood cancer in a very early stage. And the last one is, so the children who are getting exposed to these high levels of pollution, they are at a greater risk of chronic diseases such as cardiovascular diseases in a very later in their life. So these are all the impacts, which is only because of this air pollution, which is stunting the children's brain and in turn affects their health in more ways than what we actually suspected. So it has very severe effect on children's, right? So in this picture you can see, like, each year 1.7 million deaths of children under 5 are linked to this kind of environmental pollution, and these are the potential diseases due to that environmental pollution. So if you see in this picture, the air pollution is affecting the neurodevelopment and cognitive, as we saw before, and it affects the children's lung function. Even at the lower level of exposure, the children doesn't need very high level of exposure. Even at the lower level of exposure, their lung function could get affected. And as we saw before, 93% of the children under 18 are exposed to particulate matter 2.5, which is the level above WHO guidelines. And also under 5 is like 630 million and under 15 is like 1.8 billion. Deaths occurring every year due to this pollution. And one contrast comparison here is, in low and middle income countries, 98% of the children are getting affected by this particulate matter, and in high income countries it is 52%. So anyway, it is very higher. And around 6 lakh deaths across the world in children under 15 years were attributed to these kind of ambient and household air pollution. Okay, so what is the way forward here? The only way forward here is we have to improve the air quality and we have to combat the climate change. Then only we can save the lives of the children. So what we have to do? First one is we have to accelerate the switching of clean cooking and heating fuels in the home or in the households. as well as we have to promote the use of cleaner transport in order to reduce the emissions. And the next one is the energy efficient housing and urban planning should be implemented by the government in a full-fledged way. And the fourth one is low emission power generation should be adopted, as well as cleaner, safer industrial technology should also be adopted, and better municipal waste management should also be ensured. So these are all the way forward. Then only every child in our country should be able to breathe the clean air so that they can grow and fulfill their full potential. So the next article is Delhi tops national charts in bad air quality. We all knew this, that is, Delhi is the most polluted city in our country, and the WHO's report, which was released in the starting of this year, it suggested that 14 out of the 20 most polluted cities in the world are in India. So it is a major concern, right? And also one more additional factor is the Climate Trends, which is an Indian group working on environmental issues. They actually stated in their report that the first one is Delhi tops in the bad air quality nationally. It is the first thing. And in the same report, they also raised a concern that India faces the highest air pollution related mortality and disease burden in the world, with the data of 2 million deaths occurring prematurely every year, which is accounting for 25% of the global deaths due to poor air quality. So the number of deaths, especially due to this poor air quality, in that nearly 25% of the global deaths is only from India. So this shows that how much disease burden is in India due to this air pollution, which is engulfing the whole country. So what the way forward here? Because why we are so much concerning about this air pollution, in the sense, because the cost we are paying is very high. The air pollution every year nearly climbing 6.5 million lives every year. And similarly, the air pollution is the major driver for non-communicable diseases. So non-communicable disease epidemics is also more prevalent due to this air pollution. And also the third major thing is this air pollution also accelerates the climate change. So these are all the major concerns due to air pollution, right? But on the other hand, we are having perfect solutions for this also. So what are those solutions means? As we saw in the previous article, that we have to switch over to cleaner fuel, we have to switch over to cleaner transport system, as well as we have to do some better urban as well as the rural management plans. So these are all the way forward in order to make our country more pollution free environment. So these are all the cities which is most polluted in our country, the 14 cities. So the next article is CSR develops less polluting firecrackers. So the CSR scientist recently developed cheaper as well as less polluting firecracker. And it is named as safe water releaser, safe minimal aluminium, as well as safe thermite crackers. So these obviously having very lesser emissions than previous or conventional crackers. And first time in India, an emission testing facility has also been facilitated for monitoring these kind of emissions and the sounds of these crackers. So if you see, it is like 15 to 20% cheaper than the normal conventional crackers. So in these green crackers, they are not going to use this potassium nitrate and sulfur, so which in turn reduces the particulate matter, sulfur dioxide, as well as the nitrogen oxide's content nearly 30 to 35%. Instead of gaseous or smoke emissions of conventional crackers, here it is going to release water vapor or air, which is acting as a dust suppressant. So it is an environment friendly option. So the next article is India's largest dry dock at Cochin Shipyard. So what the news here is, the foundation for India's largest dry dock at Cochin Shipyard in Kerala has recently been carried out. So what is this dry dock, or what is the speciality of this dry dock, in the sense, it is an area, or it is a narrow basin or vessel which allow you to flood with water as well as drain the water alternatively according to your needs. That means if you want to ship that particular ship in the dockyard, then you are going to flood that place or flood that basin with water. And if you want to do some kind of construction activities or repair of the ships or boats or maintenance activities, then you are going to drain the water from that particular basin. So this is what the functioning or normal functioning of this dry dock, or this is the purpose of this dry dock. So this dry dock will give an impetus to Making India initiative under Sagarmala project, as well as it raise the India share in global GDP for shipbuilding from 0.66% to 2%. So the next article is places in news. So in this article, we are going to see the places regarding this Saudi Arabia as well as the Yemen crisis. So what this is in the sense, the Yemen, which is one of the Arab world's poorest countries, it is devastated by the civil war, which displaced millions of people from Yemen. So in this context, we have to know what are the areas which is surrounding the Yemen as well as the Saudi Arabia. So in this picture, we are going to see the places, that is, there are three gulfs. One is the Persian Gulf and Gulf of Oman, as well as Gulf of Aden, and two straits. One is Strait of Hormuz and Strait of Bab el Mandab, and one is Red Sea. So now we are going to see what are the places which is surrounding these things. So Red Sea is surrounded by Yemen, Saudi Arabia, Egypt, Sudan, Eritrea, as well as Djibouti. So the Persian Gulf is surrounded by UAE, Qatar, Bahrain, Kuwait, Iran, as well as Oman. Okay. And remember, there are two straits. One is Strait of Hormuz and Strait of Bab el Mandab. So the next article is Facebook leaks Redux. So this article talks about the alleged data breach around the Facebook as well as the Cambridge Analytica, which alerted the people to challenges for protecting their own data in a hyper-digitalized environment. So the news here is the world's largest social network, Facebook, hit the headlines once again on the allegation that the data breach that affected the millions of users. That means recently Facebook announced that it had discovered a security breach that had compromised nearly 50 million accounts of the ordinary people. So now we are going to see what this Cambridge Analytica. So it is a UK-based data analytics as well as advertising and consulting firm. And it is accused of sourcing the Facebook data to influence a variety of political campaigns. That means they are alleging that they are making use of the Facebook data in order to manipulate the political campaigns, especially in American Senator Ted Cruz campaign, as well as Donald Trump campaign, as well as Leave EU Brexit campaign. So in all these campaigns, these Cambridge Analytica actually made use of the Facebook data to manipulate the political campaigns. So it is a major concern, right? Because nowadays individuals are sharing their personal data, and the companies and government in turn use that data on an unprecedented scale. So they are using the data or the personal data of the users in a very large scale. So first we have to know what is this personal data means. So the personal data is simply the data that relates to an identifiable living individual, and it includes the names, email IDs, ID card numbers, physical address, as well as the IP address. So whatever the data that is related to you, if it is available on the social network or if it is available on a public domain, then it is your personal data which is available in a public domain, right? So it can easily be hacked. So what we have to ensure here is the substantial rights of the citizen should be granted with the data controllers, who are the government or the private websites who are getting the data from us. So the government or the private websites are the one who are getting the data from us, right? And similarly, we have to grant the substantial rights to the data processors as well. As that means the whatever the data which is available in the government or private websites, that is being processed on behalf of them only by these data processors. For example, Indian IT firms using the data which is outsourced by the EU firms. So the EU firms' data is outsourced to Indian IT firms, and we are manipulating that data or processing that data. So what is the actual issue here is the hackers of this Facebook account, they reportedly exploited the flaws in the code for view as feature. So in the Facebook page, they are available the view as option, right? So the flaw which is in that particular code, the hackers are making use of that flaw to steal the access tokens of that individuals. Thereby, they actually mislead or manipulate the users. So this is a major concern, right? And recently, Facebook claims to have fixed the bug as well as reset the login for all those people who are affected by means of this hacking. So whatever they have done, but the people's confidence in protection of their data in Facebook, so which was lost. So restoring that confidence is very much riskier task, right? And it is also a bone of contention. So how this data breach issue comes out? So the European Union's GDPR, which is the General Data Protection Regulation. So this is a EU law, okay? So this is an EU law on data protection and privacy for all the individuals within the European Union. And it aims to give the control to individuals over their personal data. And this recently, actually, this EU's GDPR recently forced Facebook to go public with the breach of this data of the user so promptly, even before the full extent of the damage could be assessed. So even before the entire extent of the damage because of this hacking is assessed, the EU's GDPR forced the Facebook to go public with the breach. That means they want to announce the breach to the public so that they can be more aware and alert about their data. So they also added that if any technological or tech companies are going to violate this GDPR norms, then they are going to face a potential penalty of $20 million or 4% of its global revenue. So this is a major welcome move by the EU's GDPR. So what is data protection? So data protection means protecting the individual's data which is available in the public domain. So who has to ensure this data protection means the business companies or the business entities who are collecting the data from the individuals. So what they have to do is they have to build some process that handle these kind of personal data in a very safer environment, and they should also provide the safeguard measure to protect the data using highly possible private settings. And by means of doing this, actually they can ensure that the data of that particular individual is not available publicly to anyone without the explicit and informed consent of that particular individual. So the author also suggests that there are two equally unsatisfactory options which is available in front of the users. One is either they have to resign themselves to a post-privacy world, or they have to perpetually scramble to reskill themselves in order to safely navigate this complicated and ever-evolving data privacy as well as the safety of their data. So what is the way forward here, or what are the solutions to these kind of data breach in the sense? First, we have to understand the power difference between the tech behemoths like the Facebook and the Google. So these kind of tech behemoths, they are having huge power when compared to the ordinary users like us. So what is the solution here is, first of all, we have to educate the users on how to secure their own data in their Facebook account as well as their data from the hackers. And the second one is we have to ensure a stringent criminal liability for these platforms like Facebook or Google, whoever violating these data breach. And so the third solution is GDPR, which is the EU stringent guideline. So that GDPR should be become the universal norm enforced beyond the EU jurisdiction as well. It should not only available to the EU, but it should also available universally to all, thereby protecting the ordinary users' data. So now we are going to discuss the main articles. The first one is the currency swap agreement between India and Japan. The second one is who pays taxes and who doesn't pay taxes. And the third one is the WTO. So the first main article is currency swap agreement between India and Japan. So what this article talks about is, recently, India and Japan has signed this bilateral swap agreement up to $75 billion, which means we can buy dollars from Japan at a fixed rate and we can return it at a future date in exchange of rupees. So we are buying dollar and we are returning in rupees. So first we have to know what is this currency swapping. So what does this currency swap means? So for example, consider an individual A, he's from India and he needs $1 million. So he needs that amount in terms of dollar. So he just explored different options. The one option in front of him is he can go to the US bank and he can borrow that much amount of money from US and for like 5 years, say. So while receiving the amount, for example, say $1 is equal to 70 rupees. But after 5 years, if suppose $1 has become 100 rupees, then so obviously he has to pay more than what he received from the US bank, right? So it is a major concern because he has to pay more. So the next option available in front of him is he can go to the another person who is B, who is in US, and he at the same time needs some amount of money in terms of rupees. That is, for example, consider he needs like 7 crore rupees, okay? So now what this person A is going to do is he is going to give the 7 crore rupee what B needs to him, and in turn he gets the 1 million rupee from the B. So this is what currency swapping means. So they are swapping the currencies among them. But what the major positive point here is, during this transaction or during this swapping, they signed one agreement which states that on the maturity date or after 5 years, we have to return the money, whatever we are actually transmitted. That is, whatever the original principal amount what we transfer between us, that is only we have to return back. So after 5 year, A return only $1 million and B return only 7 crore to A. So despite of the economy fluctuations or despite of the depreciation, whatever the US dollar becomes, so it become 100 rupees or 150 rupees, so it is not a concern for them and they are just swapping the currencies. So one more thing we have to note down here is the interest rates that is to be paid by these two individuals to one another. So that is also fixed. So despite of economy fluctuations or depreciation, it is also going to be constant. So this is what this currency swapping means. So it is between two individuals. So similarly, now India and Japan is also trying to do the same thing between the countries. Okay. So, but it is a little bit different. Like we are going to get $75 billion from Japan for a fixed rate. So it is a little bit different. That means we are going to get the money from Japan in terms of dollar during emergency situation or whenever we need it at a fixed rate. But while only during the maturity time, we are going to return back the money to the Japan in terms of rupees. So we are getting it in terms of dollar and we are going to return back it in terms of rupees. So that is the deal. Okay. So by means of doing all these things, we can surpass these kind of exchange rate fluctuations or interest rate fluctuations, everything, whatever prevailing in the current scenario of any country. Signing these kind of bilateral swap agreement with Japan is not new for us. Already we have done like two times in 2012 as well as in 2013. So why we are actually needing these kind of bilateral swap agreements in the sense, our forex is also becoming very low. That is $394 billion only we are now having, and it is equivalent to 9 months import only. So with that money we can import only for 9 months, and our current account deficit is also getting widened, and the global war which is also triggering the increase rate in US as well as it triggers the outflow of FII from the Indian economy this year. So these are all the factors which could possibly lead to any kind of emergency situation in the Indian economy in the future. So in order to tackle that, as a precautionary measure, we are signing this bilateral swap agreement between India and Japan. So by means of this, it is another step to instill the confidence in the Indian market. So the next article is, who pays the taxes and who doesn't pay the taxes? So recently the Central Board of Direct Taxes released data on the income tax collections in our country. So certain facts which was observed in that report is, for the last 4 years, the number of taxpayers, the number of tax returns filed, as well as the number of taxpayers reporting an income of greater than 1 crore, these all things getting increased. However, in contrast, the collections or the amount getting collected have not shown a commensurate increase in par with this increase. So in the report, they actually mentioned that the average income reported by rich Indians actually decreased. But on the other hand, the low income groups, they are paying the taxes. That is actually getting increased. So why? Because the high income individuals are grossly underreporting their income. So this is the major concern, right? And also the income declaration scheme of 2016 and other official measures which were announced by the government in order to tackle this tax evasion is also not yielding the desired results. So recently the Global Wealth Report 2018, which is released by Credit Suisse, which is a credit rating agency, in that report they stated that underreporting of income by the business entities or the business individuals, so that is the major reason why we haven't achieved the expected tax increase. And they also mentioned that the individuals who are earning like more than 50 crore, among them only 179 out of 3,400 are reporting their income. And similarly, the individuals who are earning like more than 100 crores, 61 out of 1,400 Indians are reporting their level of income. So remaining people are actually evading from paying the taxes or they are not at all reporting. So these are the reasons why we are not achieving the tax collection target as we actually estimated. So the third thing is, the share of the reported non-salary income of the individuals is also getting declined, which means the lawyers, the doctors, the accountants, who are the they are not salaried professionals, they are non-salaried professionals. So if it getting declined, in the sense these professionals are not yet included into the tax base, that is what it indicating, right? So the tax base is also not deepened among these professionals, which is in turn reflects the underreporting of these professionals' income. The last thing is, only 7% of the corporates are reporting their profit to the taxman, Remaining companies are actually avoiding paying the taxes or evading the tax paying itself, which in turn affect the direct tax collection. So the share of the direct tax in the total tax collection is also getting lowered. So this is what reported in that Credit Suisse report. So what the author suggests in this article is, because of the presumptive taxation scheme by the government as well as the GST, now the tax base of Indian economy is getting widened. That means more people are getting included into the tax base. So what is this presumptive taxation scheme in the sense? The full benefit of past evasion and escape without scrutiny simply by paying the turnover tax. In the sense, if you are not paying the tax in the past, that means if you are evading in the past, you are not coming under any scrutiny, and simply from now onwards you come and pay the tax. That is what this presumptive taxation scheme. So it actually encourages more people to come into the ambit of paying the taxes. So also the government is trying to increase the threshold from 1 crore to 2 crore. So it is also a major positive step because it attracts more number of filers under this presumptive scheme, and the taxpayers has also increased from 14.93 lakh to 1.17 crore, which is a 681% increase in the tax base itself. So by means of this GST, that means by means of formalizing the tax structure, the semi-formal as well as the mid-size companies is now coming under the ambit of GST, and they can't evade the tax paying, right? But this GST can't help the tax evasion or the avoidance by the high income individual or the big corporates. So we have to address this issue also. Okay. So what are the reforms that we need in these tax laws in the sense? The first one is, the law should mandate filing of returns by all the professionals and the businesses regardless of their profit. So this should be a mandate which would in turn enable to scrutinize the suspicious cases if at all occur. So the second thing is, for the companies whichever claiming the bogus expenses, so they should also coming under the ambit of systematic investigation by the income tax department. So this these companies usually what they do is, they are claiming some bogus expenses or fake expenses in order to artificially reduce their profit, and hence they can evade the tax payment at all. So to overcome that also, we have to do some systematic investigation. So that is the second reform. And the third one is, we have to integrate the GST, income tax in the Ministry of the Corporate Affairs database in order to make it much more efficient for easily scrutinizing the tax evaders as well as the tax avoidance individuals as well as the businesses. So this will only deepen the tax base among the high income groups as well as the professionals in the future. So the last article is, the WTO, which is the World Trade Organization, is it all over or can something be done? So this article talks about that recently US President Donald Trump, he declared that US might walk out of the WTO if the WTO is not rectifying its mistake, stating that the WTO itself is a catastrophe or disaster institution. So this statement by Donald Trump put other countries or other major trading partners of US in a worried situation. And he has also done a lot of unilateral actions by means of putting tariffs on several items which are outside the WTO framework, like steel, aluminium tariff, as well as the discriminatory tariff against China. So these are all indicate the unilateral action which is taken by President Donald Trump against China as well as against other emerging economies. So these discriminatory tariff which is put forward by the US against China, it also indicates that it is the US is following a pure protectionist attitude, and the US is justifying by means of saying that we are doing it against China because the China is following non-transparent subsidized enterprises. They are having these kind of non-transparent subsidized enterprises, so for punitive action only we are putting these kind of discriminatory tariff against China. This is what the US is stating. So what is the major concern here is, in a world which is characterized by the global supply chain, we should be open and we should not be a protectionist. So these kind of tariffs on China as well as on other emerging economy will obviously affect the countries upstream of the supply chain. So it is going to be the mismatch of the supply and the demand of the raw materials or the anything which is happening between the US as well as the other country. Our global economy is already facing this downside risk. But these kind of discriminatory tariffs against each other is going to result in uncertainty about the investment decisions by the businesses, which in turn further weakening the global economy as a whole. And this looming threat is obviously created the space for Ottawa Communique. So what is this Ottawa Communique? We are going to see it in the next slide. So now we are going to see what is this Ottawa Communique and what they are telling about the WTO and its importance. So the Ottawa Communique is an association of 13 members of WTO who recently have met in Canada for discussing reformation of WTO framework. So what they actually mentioned here is, we have to reaffirm that is the WTO is a rules-based multilateral trading system, and it is only facilitating and safeguarding the trade which is happening between the countries in the world. So it is indispensable. So this is what they stated about the importance of WTO. And they also stated some of the major concerns of WTO. The first one is improving the WTO's dispute resolution mechanism. So if you see WTO, it is having certain thing which is called as dispute resolution mechanism in order to resolve the disputes between the countries in terms of trade disputes. And the second one is monitoring the transparency of member country trade practices. And the third one is reinvigorating the WTO negotiating practices. So now we are going to see all these things one by one. So the first major concern is improving the WTO's DSM, which is the dispute resolution mechanism. So what is the concern which is revolving around here is, actually the US has blocked the appointments of the members into this DSM. So it is actually having a composition of 7 members, but as of now only 3 members are there. So US is further blocking the appointments of any other members into this DSM, which is obviously reducing the say of that particular institution itself. So we have to strengthen this dispute resolution mechanism. This is what the first proposal is. So the second major concern is, we have to monitor the transparency of the member countries' trade practices. So whoever the member countries of the WTO, their trade practices should be closely monitored. For example, say in case of China, due to the prevalence of large state-controlled industry in China, they are actually following some kind of unfair trade practices all over the world. So the transactions which is happening in and out of China, it is also causing, it is not transparent or it is not open. So it is causing the trade distortion all over the world. And it in turn affects not only the US, but also all the countries who are getting the trade relationship with China. So what the solution here is, whatever happened in the past, but what we actually needed here is some kind of minimum transparency should be expected from all the countries in terms of their trade transactions. So the last major concern is reinvigorating the WTO negotiating process. So the negotiating process which has happened within the WTO, it should be reformed. So how it can be done in the sense, we have to reconsider the WTO's consensus rule. In the sense, before it was like everyone or every member of the WTO should accept to a particular agreement, then only it is come into force. So even if one country is against that particular agreement, then it is not coming into force. So it is actually blocking the further progress of the institution or its laws or agreements itself, right? So what we have to do is, instead of following this consensus rule, we have to switch over to something like majority rule. So majority voting, in the sense, the voting strength of each and every country should be based on their share in the global trade. So as like IMF and World Bank, we are having these kind of things, right? I mean, whatever the country's global trade share, depend on that amount only their voting is desired. Similarly, here also we should follow the same thing. And in that also, only if 85% of vote is achieved for a particular deal, then only it should be further progressed. And the second alternative approach to this is, we have to allow the plurilateral agreements such as ASEAN, BIMSTEC, as well as TPP. So these are plurilateral agreements. So we have to include these people also into the WTO in order to making them vote for a particular deal or agreement so that it become more effective. So these proactive measures are required to protect the WTO from further collapse. So the author concluded by saying that the G20 countries can also play a major role in bringing reforms to the WTO, because in the past, especially during the 2008 financial crisis, this G20 countries was only helping the global economies to recover from its crisis. Similarly, now also they can come and bring some reforms in the WTO. So this is what the author suggested in this article. Thank you.